In the Old Testament, Jesus said, "All who hate me love death." Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Accepting him as your Lord and Savior and choosing to follow him puts you on the way. Obeying the truth of God's word keeps you on the way that ends in eternal life. Your eternal destiny will be determined by your choices in this world. Steps to Life exists to help people find the way, the truth, and the life.
Let's pray that the Lord will help us to understand what we're going to study. Father in heaven, we thank you for the wonderful, exciting hope that we have in the soon coming of Jesus. And we know that very soon there will only be two classes of people in this world, those that have faith and those that are terrified. And we earnestly pray that you will teach us that we might understand not just what is coming, how to be ready for it, but most of all, to be ready for the coming of Jesus. So guide us in our study now, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. In ancient times, cities had walls around them, and those walls were for the protection of the people. They didn't have airplanes or machine guns or explosives. And so if you had a powerful wall around your city, it offered protection. However, an enemy army could be sent to besiege your city. And so the cities appointed watchmen to stand on the walls of the city and watch and see that there was no harm or danger coming from outside. Ellen White makes this comment about these watchmen. The watchmen anciently placed upon the walls of Jerusalem and other cities occupied a most responsible position. Upon their faithfulness depended the safety of all within these cities. When danger was apprehended, they were not to keep silent day nor night. Every few moments they were required to call to one another to see if all were awake and no harm had come to any. Sentinels were stationed upon some eminence overlooking the important posts to be guarded, and the cry of warning or of good cheer was sounded from them. This was borne from one to another, each repeating the words till it went the entire rounds of the city. Then she makes this comment. These watchmen represent the ministry upon whose fidelity depends the salvation of souls. The stewards of the mysteries of God should stand as watchmen upon the walls of Zion, and if they see the sword coming, they should sound the note of warning. If they are sleepy sentinels and their spiritual senses are so benumbed that they see and realize no danger, and the people perish, God will require their blood at the watchman's hands. Now, if you're a minister, that's a very scary paragraph to read. If you know what's coming and you don't tell people what's coming, well, when they perish, you'll be held responsible. Do you know what's coming? Of course, you say, well, I know the second coming of Christ is coming soon. That's true. But before the second coming of Christ, there's other things that are going to come. There's other things that are going to happen. Somebody says, well, there's a national Sunday law coming. That's true. You know it's going to happen before that. Let me tell you what is happening right now. And from what is happening right now, when I read prophecy, I understand what is going to happen, and I decided, I wasn't planning to preach on this, but when I found all this out and when I checked it out, I said, I have an obligation. I have to tell God's people about this so that I'm not blamable. Now, we read in our scripture this morning in Ezekiel 3, if the watchman gives the warning and people don't listen, well, then he's not held accountable. But the watchman has to give the warning of what's happening. What's happening? Are you all aware that within the last few months, approximately 300,000 people have left New York City? This has never happened before in the history of the United States. Are you aware of the fact that all the large cities, people are emptying out, they're leaving the large cities, Los Angeles, Chicago, all the large cities, people are leaving these large cities. You understand why this is going on? Are you aware of the fact that in the last few days, former President Trump purchased an island off the coast of the United States, and so he's not even in the continental United States, he's on a little island. And he's not the only one that's done that. Former President Obama did the same thing. And rich people all over the United States are doing things like that. They're buying little islands someplace that's offshore. What are they trying to get away? What are they trying to get? Why are they trying to escape? What are they trying to escape from? Do you know? It is because, friends, that they foresee the rich people in this country, the prominent people in this country, foresee terrible trouble and danger developing in all the large centers of population in this country. The unrest and rioting that is impending in these large cities, and it's directly connected, by the way, with the price of food. Are you aware that between 2008 and 2010, the price of food went up over 20%? You aware of that? Do you understand why that happened? Are you aware of the fact that the same thing that happened then is going to happen in a far more accelerated rate now and in the near future? Do you understand that one of the directors of the food bank at Dallas said, we've never had this many people try to get the food bank. Are you aware of the fact that in many large cities, people are standing in lines, sometimes over a mile long, to get food at the food bank? We've never had things like that happen since the Depression in the 1930s. Why can't they get food? Why can't they can't afford to buy it? Why can't they afford to buy it? There is before us the prospect of such a sharp rise in food prices, that we are going to see people hungry all over the United States, and especially in the large cities. Because they will not be able to purchase food, even if they have a job, because the price will be so high. So there is an impending food crisis. Some people say we're already there in the United States. What do these things mean, and what should we as God's people be doing about it? What does prophecy tell us is going to happen in the very last days just before the second coming of Christ? Let me read to you a statement that I have pondered for many years, trying to understand it. I never did understand it until this week. I understand it now. Here's the statement. It says, in India, China, those are two of the most populous countries of the world, Russia, and the cities of America, thousands of men and women are dying of starvation. Now, this is a prophecy. Are people going to die of starvation in the cities of America? Yes, they are. Do you know what happens when large groups of people don't have any food and can't find any? Do you know what happens? Now, Ellen White explains why this is going on, and it's happening right now. I never figured out what was going on until this last week. I got it figured out. Here's what's happening. The moneyed men, because they have the power, control the market. This market for commodities, food. They purchase at low rates all they can obtain and then sell at greatly increased prices. This means starvation to the poorer classes and will result in a civil war. There will be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation. Here is another similar statement. This was written in 1906. The one I just read was written in 1899. The Lord calls for His people to locate away from the cities. For in such an hour as ye think not, fire and brimstone will be rained from heaven upon these cities. Proportionate to their sins will be their visitation. The judgment will be proportionate to what? The sins. When one city is destroyed, let not our people regard this matter as a light affair and think that they may, if favorable opportunity offers, build themselves homes in that same destroyed city. Don't decide you're going to go down and build yourself a home in New Orleans. When that happened, by the way, in 2005, people that weren't Adventists in Wichita told me, they said, that city will never get rebuilt. The damage is too great. Then she says, let all who would understand the meaning of these things read the 11th chapter of Revelation. And that statement was a mystery to me for a long time. Because do you know the first 14 verses of the chapter 11 of Revelation, do you know what that's about? It's about the French Revolution. That's what the first 14 verses of Revelation 11 are about. It's about the French Revolution. And Ellen White says, if you want to understand the meaning, study every verse of Revelation 11. And remember, the bulk of the chapter of Revelation 11 is about the French Revolution. Then here's what she says. Let all who would understand the meaning of these things read the 11th chapter of Revelation, read every verse, and learn the things that are yet to take place in the cities. Astonishing. Read the chapter in the Bible that gives you a detailed explanation, a detailed prophecy of the French Revolution, and then know that that's what's going to happen in the cities of America. It's already started. Read also the scenes portrayed in the 18th chapter of the same book. We need to face the fact that we are facing troublous times. Our trust needs to be in the Lord and not in what we can do, and yet we are to follow directions. Because of the troublous times that God foresaw would happen over 100 years ago, God told His people, because of what's going to happen, I want you to do this. We haven't listened too carefully. And if we don't listen, we will pay the consequences. I don't want you to pay the consequences. Well,
If I don't want you to pay the consequences, I need to be sure and tell you what the Lord said to do so that you wouldn't have to suffer the consequences.
So, I want to, first of all, state, so that there will be no confusion, there is coming upon not just this country, but upon the whole world, a time of trouble such as never been since there was a nation. That's clearly predicted in Bible prophecy. And in that time, you will not be able to buy or sell, period. And you cannot get ready for that time by making any kind of a physical type of preparation. I was so happy to hear Sister Esther quote in Sabbath School that reference from Desire of Ages, page about 120, where Ellen White says that in the last controversy, in the last conflict, those that are faithful to the Lord will see every earthly support cut off. If every earthly support is cut off, then there's no way that you can prepare for something like that, because anything that you can prepare on the earth, it'll be cut off. Well, how will you survive? You won't survive except by the promise of God. And God, when studying in Sabbath School about the children of Israel walking through the wilderness, there was no water and there was no food. And you have 2 million people in a desert with no water and no food. That is not a problem for God. God fed them for 40 years in the wilderness, and He gave them food and water for 40 years, a place where there was no food and no water to be had. That was not a problem for God. It's a problem for us. What's our problem? Our problem is trusting that God can do it. That's our problem. So that time is coming, and we are not to try to prepare physically for that time, because it wouldn't do any good. Here's what Ellen White says about that. For 2 years past, the Lord has shown me in vision repeatedly that it is contrary to the Bible to make any provision for our temporal wants in the time of trouble. I saw that if the saints have food laid up by them or in the fields in the time of trouble when sword, famine, and pestilence are in the land. Notice she mentions three things. Be sword, that'd be riots with killing. Famine, won't be enough food. Pestilence, what's a pestilence? Have you ever looked up recently the definition of a pestilence? A pestilence is a terrible disease that is contagious, that spreads through a population. That's a pestilence. During the time of trouble, there'll be the sword, there'll be famine, there won't be enough food, and there'll be pestilence all at the same time. When sword, famine, and pestilence are in the land, it will be taken from them by violent hands, and strangers will reap their fields. Then will be the time for us to trust wholly in God, and He will sustain us. I saw that our bread and water would be sure at that time, and we should not lack or suffer hunger. The Lord has shown me that some of His children would fear when they see the price of food rising. Now, that's an interesting statement. As we approach a time of trouble, some of God's children are going to be afraid. And why are they going to be afraid? Because they're going to see the price of food rising. If you live for a few more months or years, you're going to see that. Much worse than you saw it in 2008 or 2010. The Lord has shown me that some of His children would fear when they see the price of food rising, and they would buy food and lay it by for the time of trouble. So, you go and you buy a pickup load full of food so that you'll be ready for the time of trouble, and you store it in your cellar. He says, then in a time of need, I saw them go to their food and look at it, and it had bred worms and was full of living creatures and not fit for use. About 1 week since, the Lord showed me in vision that houses and lands would be of no use in the time of trouble, and in that time they could not be disposed of. I saw it was the will of God that the saints should cut loose from every encumbrance, dispose of their houses and lands before the time of trouble comes, and make a covenant with God by sacrifice. I saw they would sell if they laid their property on the altar and earnestly inquired for duty. Then God will teach them when to dispose of these things. They will be free in the time of trouble and have no clogs to weigh them down. So we are not to make physical preparation for the great time of trouble.
You won't be able to buy or sell anything. I thought this through for many years, tried to figure it out, because there's been so much confusion in the Adventist church about this. We have Adventists that are trying to go to caves and get up systems so they have their own hydroelectric power, they have their own garden, they produce their own food, they're totally self-sustaining, they can make it without having to buy and sell. Let me tell you something, friend. When that time comes, you will not be able to make it, no matter what preparation you made, unless the Lord sustained you. It's going to be just like the children of Israel in the wilderness. You're not going to be able to make it unless the Lord sustained you. But if you're one of His children and you put your trust in Him, He is going to sustain you.
We need to pray that we will have increased faith, not presumption, but increased faith.
But before the great time of trouble comes, there are other troubles going to come upon this world, which we're experiencing right now. And God foresaw these minor troubles coming too. He foresaw all that. And so the Lord sent to us over 100 years ago warnings, do this so that you're ready for when this happens. What has He told us? We're not going to study right now about being ready for the great time of trouble. There's no way that you can make any preparation so that you'd be ready. From a physical point of view, this preparation for the great time of trouble is spiritual, not physical. It's not going to do you a bit of good to store a truckload of water or food or anything else for that time. It's not going to do good for saying, well, I got to have this medicine. I'm going to get a whole bunch of it, so I'll have enough for the next 10. It's not going to do you good to make all those kind of preparations. You're going to lose all that. Somebody will take it violently away from you. We just read that. But before that time comes, there are going to come other, I call them more minor troubles, but what we call more minor troubles are actually pretty major. They're going to come upon the world. And the Lord has given us instruction in preparation for what's going to happen. This is what you need to do. We're not talking about preparation for the great time of trouble. That preparation is spiritual. Being ready for the close of probation, the great time of trouble, has to do with my character. Do I have the robe of Christ's righteousness on? Is my life, is my heart, am I heart to heart with Jesus, with what He's trying to do in this world? That's the preparation that I have to make for the great time of trouble. I have to be heart to heart with the Lord. I have to be covered with His righteousness, with His robe of righteousness, and I have to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And if I don't have that kind of preparation, it doesn't matter what else I have, it's not going to do any good. But before that time comes, there are some things that God's people are to do.
Well, what are we to do? Remember, Ellen White wrote, let all who would understand the meaning of these things read the 11th chapter of Revelation, read every verse, and learn the things that are yet to take place. Where? In the cities.
Are you aware of the fact? Are you all aware of the fact that before we reach the end of time, some things are going to happen in the cities that are not going to happen in the country? Are you aware of that? You think God's aware of that? He was aware of that hundreds of years ago. And so, because God knew what we didn't know, He gave to us some warnings, some instructions what to do. Would it be all right with you if I read to you counsels of what God told us to do for the time that we're living in right now? He told us a long time ago. We need to pay attention. So, if it's all right with all of you, I want to read to you some counsels that God gave to us a long time ago. Remember what I read about the price of food going so high that the poor people couldn't afford it, and that there'd be starvation in all the cities in, in China and India and Russia and the cities of the United States, there'll be starvation. Why? Because there's no food? No, because people can't afford to buy it. Price is too high. Now notice what the Lord said to do. This is over 100 years ago the Lord said to do this. So you'd be ready for when that happened. Here's what it says. This is Last Day Events, page 95. You can also find it in two selected messages, page 356. It was written in 1903, over 100 years ago. Get out of the cities as soon as possible. What did the Lord say to do? Get out of the cities as soon as possible. I'm afraid of running out of time. I want to be sure that I cover this before we run out of time. I don't want somebody to misinterpret what we're studying and get themselves in trouble. And I have a whole bunch of quotations here on this subject, and I don't think I'll have time to read them. But let me just mention this. With whatever you do, anybody that's listening right now, or if you're listening to this sermon recorded somewhere, whatever you do, do not take what we're studying and do something rash that's not well thought through and that you haven't prayed about and talked to the Lord about. If you're living right in the middle of New York City or Chicago or Los Angeles, do not just say, well, I'm going to go and not pray about it and ask the Lord to show you what to do. Ask the Lord to lead you. Don't just say, well, okay, I'm going. I could tell you horror stories one after another of people that have done this. They heard, they read these things, and they were living in Los Angeles or some big city, and they said, okay, I'm leaving. And they got out. They got themselves in a situation where they lost almost all their assets. They got themselves in such a bad situation, they ended up, actually, some of them returning clear back to Los Angeles just to survive. They got themselves in a bad situation in country living. They weren't prepared for it. So please, we're going to read the statements. If we have time, I'll read you the cautions. But whatever you do, if you need to get out of a city, don't do something rash without praying to the Lord and asking Him to lead you and guide you and taking time to get counsel from somebody that knows something about living in the country. It's always scary to me when people that have lived in the city all their life, they decide they're going out to the country. They have no idea what's involved in living out in the country. They've never lived in the country before. And so they do something rash, ill-advised, and they get themselves in terrible financial and economic difficulty. Please, don't do anything rash. But we're going to read the statements. Notice she didn't say to get out of the cities right now. What did she say? She said, get out as soon as possible. As soon as possible means that you don't do it until you have prayed about it and laid your plans before the Lord, until you have sought counsel from people that are experienced with country living and know something about it. But she does say, get out of the cities as soon as possible. And then when you get out of the cities as soon as possible, here's the next piece of advice that the Lord gives you. This is very interesting. I have pondered this statement, actually, for over 50 years. He says, get out of the cities as soon as possible and purchase a little piece of land where you can have a garden. Do what when you get out of the cities? Purchase a little piece of land. Little piece of land. Don't purchase so much you can't even take care of it. A little piece of land where you can do what? Have a garden. Do you understand, friends, that the time is coming when the price of food is going to be so exorbitantly high that the people that have plenty to eat that aren't rich people will be the people that have gardens? Are you aware of that? If you want to get ready for that time, what should you be doing right now? Now, the thing that's scary to me about this, you know, it steps to life for over 20 years. We have offered people garden space around here. Nobody's interested. It takes work to grow a garden. There's only a handful of people that want to go to the work of growing a garden. It's so much easier. You know, go to Dillon's or Walmart or Safeway. It's so much easier. Just go down there and pay for it and get it. Yep, you can keep doing that. What are you going to do when the price is 5 or 10 times more than it is right now? You're going to keep doing it? The time is coming, friends, and it could be sooner than you think. when the only people among the middle class that will have enough to eat are the people that have gardens. That could happen. It says, this is what the Lord told us in 19:3. Get out of the cities as soon as possible and purchase a little piece of land where you can have a garden. Get out of the cities as soon as possible and purchase a little piece of land where you can have a garden. The time is fast coming when the controlling power of the labor unions will be very oppressive. Again and again, the Lord has instructed that our people are to take their families away from the cities into the country where they can raise their own provisions. What are we supposed to do when you go to the country? We're supposed to plant a garden where we can raise our own provisions. Why? Now notice this. This statement, by the way, has been grossly misinterpreted. This statement is not talking about the time of Jacob's trouble or the time of the great time of trouble. It's not talking about that. It's talking about the time we're living in right now, before that happens. When that happens, it won't do you any good to have a garden or be in the, anywhere. That won't do you a speck of good. You're not going to be able to buy or sell. And even if you have a garden, so you're going to have to flee. It's not going to do you any good to have a garden then. It's not going to do you any good to be, you know, be living out in the country. You're going to have to flee, whether you're in the city or the country. We're not talking about that. But this is talking about before that time happens, the time we're living in right now. Notice what it says. The Lord has instructed that our people are to take their families away from the cities into the country where they can raise their own provisions, for in the future, the problem of buying and selling will be a very serious one. I wondered for years, what is that talking about? It does not say that you won't be able to buy and sell. It's not talking about that time. That's a great time. It is not talking about when you cannot buy or sell. It's talking about the time we're living in right now. What is it about buying and selling that will become serious? What will become serious is that you won't be able to have enough money to afford it. That's what will be so serious. Things will be available, but you won't be able to pay the price. If you're not raising at least some of your own food, you're going to be in serious trouble unless you're a very wealthy person. Thought leaders, you know, there are reasons that most people don't understand why billionaires are purchasing these little islands off the coast of the United States and getting completely out of the country. There's reasons why people that aren't quite that wealthy, are worldly people, are getting out of the cities by the millions, 300,000 out of New York City alone. Worldly people see it coming. In the future, the problem of buying and selling will be a very serious one. We should now begin to heed the instruction given us over and over again. Get out of the cities into rural districts where the houses are not crowded closer together and where you'll be free from the interference of enemies. There is even another reason. There is even another reason. We're getting out of these cities. We're not talking about getting out of the cities after probation closes. We're talking about before all that, the time we're living right now. Before probation closes, I personally believe it will be before there's any national Sunday law, but you can decide it out for yourself and decide for yourself. Before all that, in my opinion, before the national Sunday law and long before probation closes, what's going to happen in these big cities? Well, what's going to happen in these big cities is, it's not just the riots, it's not just a French revolutionary type of activity that's going to happen. Something else is going to happen that mankind is not prepared for and are going to be shocked out of their wits when it happens. And I've talked about this in a previous sermon, so we're not going to go into that in detail now. But what's going to happen is, these large cities are going to be visited by divine judgments. Why is that? Why is it that, you know, usually when we look at divine judgment, people think, well, that's what's going to happen during the time of trouble. Well, yeah, it's going to happen during the time of trouble. But what we're talking about is going to happen before probation closes. I believe before the National Sunday Law, these big cities are going to be visited by divine judgments. Why will they be visited by divine judgments? There are very specific reasons. Now, sometimes when we talk about this, we quote the statements where it says that God, and I've read this over and over again, God keeps an exact record, an exact account with every individual, with every church, with every city, with every state, with every nation. God keeps an exact account of what's going on. Our Creator knows every detail of what's going on in this world, my friends. He knows every detail of your life, personal life. He knows every detail of your family life. He knows every detail of what's going on in the church you attend or the institution you work at. He knows all of that. And God keeps an account of the sins of mankind. Does the Bible say that? It certainly does. God has a record, of an addition record, of all the sins that are committed in every city. And what kind of sins? He has that all tabulated. He has a record. And it's filling up, and it's filling up, and it's more, and it's more. And God has fixed a line. We don't know where it is. We know, we're told that He has fixed a line. And when it gets to that level, the Lord says, all right, you're going to have judgments. And the purpose of these judgments is not like the judgments that are going to happen during the time of Jacob's trouble, those kind of things that are coming on the world, not like that. The purpose of these judgments that are coming on the cities is because God is seeking to save people. And sometimes the level of sinful activity reaches such a height, the only way left that anybody can be saved is if this place suffers divine judgments, and so they're going to receive divine judgments. And as a result of that, there will be a few people that will come to their senses and be saved. Let me read that to you. Calamities will come. Calamities most awful, most unexpected. And these destructions will follow one after another. If there will be a heeding of the warnings that God has given, and if churches will repent, notice that if churches will repent. By the way, we all need to study the subject of repentance and say, have I repented? If churches will repent, returning to their allegiance, then other cities may be spared for a time. If churches repent, there'll be mercy. Other cities may be spared for a time. But if men who have been deceived continue in the same way in which they have been walking, disregarding the law of God and presenting falsehoods before the people, God allows them to suffer calamity that their senses may be awakened. God's trying to save some people. By the way, I don't want to hurt your feelings, but we need to face the facts. Some of the actual trials and calamities that we go through individually, we're going through it because the Lord's trying to wake us up and help us to get ready for the kingdom of heaven so we don't lose our soul. Pray about that. The devil's tempting you and me to complain and murmur when we get into dire trouble. Maybe God allowed some trouble to decide to save me. Maybe I should talk to him about that. What am I supposed to be learning from this? The Lord will not suddenly cast off all transgressors or destroy entire nations, but he will punish cities and places where men have given themselves up to the possession of satanic agencies. Strictly will the cities of the nations be dealt with, and yet they will not be visited in the extreme of God's indignation, because some souls will yet break away from the delusions of the enemy and will repent and be converted, while the mass will be treasuring up wrath against the day of wrath. It won't do any good for most of the people, but there will be a few people in these cities that receive judgments that will wake up and repent and be converted and be saved, and that's why they're allowed to happen. God's trying to save some people. It's so much nicer the way it used to be, when the way you can be saved is you hear a preacher somewhere preach the gospel, or some Bible worker somewhere gives you a Bible study, and you listen, and you repent, you become converted, you become baptized, and you're on the road to the kingdom of God. It's so much nicer when it can happen that way. But the time comes, the wickedness increases so much that the people that can be reached that way have already been reached, and the only way you can reach any of the rest of the people is for them to experience judgments. And we're there, friends. We are going to experience judgments in this country like we've never seen before. There are reasons why we should not build in the cities. On these cities, God's judgments are soon to fall. The time is near when large cities will be swept away, and all should be warned of these coming judgments. Oh, that God's people had a sense of the impending destruction of thousands of cities now almost given to idolatry. I read to you some statements in a recent sermon having to do with the destruction of cities and the sudden destruction that was coming. We're not going to go into those statements. Just pay attention to what God's trying to tell us. Because God foresaw it all, and God didn't want you to have to experience. God didn't want His children to have to experience Katrina. Everyone that listened wouldn't have experienced it. They'd have gotten, that was a huge wicked city. They'd have been out of there. It's not over yet. The large cities are going to. What we see now is rioting and civil destruction. What we haven't seen yet in the large cities in America is the judgments of God falling markedly on these cities, in which there will be sudden destruction of a huge amount of human life. Now, before we end, I do want to read. We're going to skip statements so we could read more about these judgments. And I want to read, first of all, what the Lord has told us to do. He told us to get out of the cities as soon as possible, and to do what when we get out? Purchase a little piece of land where you can do what? Grow a garden. There's an important reason for every counsel that God gives to His people. And if we're wise, we need to pay attention to the whole counsel and say, okay, I need to get out of the city, but I need to do more than that. I need to get a little piece of land where I can grow a garden. Don't wait until the price of food is 10 times what it is now. Ellen White says, if the land is cultivated, it will, with the blessing of God, supply our necessities. We should work the soil cheerfully, hopefully, gratefully. The time has come when, as God opens the way, notice, it's as God opens the way, as God opens the way, families should move out of the cities. The children should be taken into the country. The parents should get as suitable a place as their means will allow. Though the dwelling may be small, yet there should be land in connection with it that may be cultivated. Now, when these councils were first given, they had a meeting at the Battle Creek Church. They studied these things. When the councils were first given. And you know what happened? About 200 people in the Battle Creek Church says, we're moving out of Battle Creek. And when they decided that, one of the persons wrote a letter to Ellen White, and this person said, about 200 people in the Battle Creek Church decided to move out of Battle Creek. I want to read to you what Ellen White responded to that. He said, I have seen that danger attends every new phase of experience in the church. Because some hear things with such a strong spirit. While some teachers may be strong and efficient in teaching in the lines of Bible doctrines, they will not all be men who have a knowledge of practical life and can advise perplexed minds with surety and safety. They do not discern the perplexing situation that must necessarily come to every family who shall make a change. When you make a major change, what happens? You get into perplexing situations. Therefore, let all be careful what they say. If they know not the mind of God in some matters, let them never speak from a guess or suppose so. If they know nothing definite, let them say so, and let the individual rely wholly upon God. Let there be much praying done, and even with fasting, that not one shall move in darkness, but move in the light as God is in the light. Let there be nothing done in a disorderly manner, that there shall be a great loss or sacrifice made upon property because of ardent, impulsive speeches which stir up an enthusiasm which is not after the order of God, that a victory that was essential to be gained shall, for lack of level-headed moderation and proper contemplation, be turned into a defeat. Let there be wise generalship in this matter, and all move under the guidance of a wise, unseen counselor, which is God. Well, you have the book Country Living. You can read even more about that on pages 27, 28, 29, where she cautions, be careful, do not do anything rashly or impulsively. He says, spread every plan before God with fasting and with the humbling of the soul before the Lord Jesus, and commit thy ways unto the Lord. The sure promise is he will direct your paths. He is infinite in resources. My dear friends, God gave us these warnings over 100 years ago so that if you're one of his children, if you're one of his remnant people, you would not have to go through the terrible trouble that is going to come on everybody that's living in one of these large cities. The Lord said, I'm going to spare my people that. But we thought, because of the devil's deceptions, that the Lord was asking us to do something that would be a terrible trial. We're just like the children of Israel. My dear friend, everything, every counsel that God has given comes from a heart of infinite love who is looking out for your good, who wants you to be preserved and to be ready to meet Jesus and to have eternal life. And my dear friends, if you look around, if you have faith, we're living in the most exciting time of Earth's history. You aware of that? We're living in the time when all the apostles and prophets wished they could live. They wished they could live in our time. Ellen White and James White wished that they could live in our time. Why? Because they wanted to see Jesus come. And Jesus is coming soon. And there is going to be a people who will listen to what God has to say and who will be ready to meet him. And I want to be one of those people. Do you want to be one of those people? You want to be one of the people. Let's read it. Look in Luke 21. Starting with verse 34. Take heed to yourselves, lest your hearts be weighed down with carousing, drunkenness, and cares of this life, and that day come on you unexpectedly, for it will come as a snare, that's like a trap, on all those who dwell on the face of the whole earth. Watch therefore and pray always that you may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that will come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man. Would you like that to be fulfilled in your life? Follow the directions. Read verses 34 to 36 carefully. Let's pray before we sing our closing song. Father in heaven, we know that the way this world is going to end is going to be like a trap. While people are looking for what they think has to be fulfilled in prophecy, they will find out that it's already been fulfilled and they didn't recognize what was happening, and now the Lord's coming. And Lord, we know that any of us, we could be surprised. We could be surprised by the fact that the second coming occurs sooner than we thought. Lord, we pray that you'll help us to watch and pray always, to follow directions,
so that we may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that are coming and to stand before our Master with peace and joy at his appearing. We pray in his name. Amen.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org, and our web address is www.stepstolife.org. May God be with you as you seek to walk the narrow way.